We all know what these things are. The full-size versions of solar panels and wind turbines are cropping up all over the place. And that's a great thing for our environment, right? Green energy and all that. And in 2018, there was a report out by a big Norwegian classification and risk management company called DNVGL that said there'd be a growth of 6,500% from 290 gigawatts of solar in 2016 to 19,000 gigawatts in 2050. It also said that wind and solar combined by then would be providing 2/3 of all the world's electricity. Well, that's a lot of turbines and a lot of solar panels, and these things are generally rated for a life cycle of about 30 years. So that does beg a question. What happens to them then? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. You could say that both these energy generators are wonders of our modern age, seemingly conjuring electrical energy from thin air and sunshine. But to achieve the conversions of energy that are needed to make these things work requires a multitude of different types of materials. And unless those materials can be efficiently separated out at the end of the product's useful life, then just like any other unloved piece of hardware, there's a fair chance they'll get hurled into landfill along with everything else that we can't be bothered to deal with responsibly. In a recent Forbes online article, Jeff McMahon tells us the United States installs £7 million per day of solar panels, according to the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, a pace that secures only fourth place among countries for installed capacity. Those numbers are also considered in this comprehensive 2018 article by Kelly Pickerel for Solar Power World. Kelly sets out the size of the challenge very clearly. In 2017, the United States installed 10.6 gigawatts of new solar energy. Using rough mathematics, if every panel was 300 watts, that's 35.3 million new solar panels installed last year. In about 30 years, a wave of 35.3 million panels may reach the end of their lifespans, not counting the hundreds of millions of panels that flooded the US market in the last decade that may need to be disposed of sooner. And then there's wind turbines. Huge behemoths of steel and composite materials like glass fibre and thermoplastics. Modern turbines can reach heights of over 200 metres or 720 feet, with blades that are often more than 50 metres long. The distribution of wind power across the globe is not dissimilar to solar. According to the Global Wind Energy Council, there were 341,000 turbines around the world at the end of 2016, and that number's bound to be much bigger now, thanks mainly to the exponential growth in India and China over the past couple of years. Add to that the hundreds of millions of solar panels that we've just talked about, and you've got a serious amount of hardware that's going to need to be dealt with over the course of the coming decades and beyond. When these technologies were in their fledgling stages, I think it's fair to say that no one was really paying any attention to what would be done with the materials at the end of their lifespan. It was really just a massive frenzied rush to get economies of scale built into their production to bring the costs down so that these things could be competitive against the dominant technologies of fossil fuel and nuclear. That race has been pretty successfully run now, and the costs of both solar and wind are firmly established as being extremely competitive with, if not cheaper than, the traditional energy sources of oil, coal, gas and nuclear. But end-of-life disposal and recycling is still a potential Achilles heel for renewables. So how's the industry been responding? Well, the answer to that question depends on which part of the world you're looking at. Here in Europe, there are strong regulations around the disposal of waste electrical and hazardous substances, and the recycling of solar panels and wind turbines is already very high on the agenda of manufacturers and policymakers. According to the organisation Green Match, over 70% of the European PV manufacturers are part of the PV Cycle Network. Members of the network show commitment to create a product which is sustainable both during production and after purchase. They realise this through mindful eco-design, the elimination of toxic materials usage, and through recycling. According to GreenMatch, the recycling process differs slightly for the two main types of solar panel, thin film-based panels and the more common silicon-based panels. Silicon panels are dismantled and heated to 500 degrees Celsius. The glass and metals are recovered and reused. The plastic coverings evaporate and the heat from the combustion is recaptured and recycled into the system. The process means that 85% of the silicon, 95% of the glass and 100% of the metal is recycled. Thin film panels are shredded into 4 or 5 millimeter pieces before having the various materials separated out with mechanical and chemical processes. This method results in 95% of semiconductor material reuse and 90% of glass. In 2018, Veolia opened Europe's first large-scale PV recycling facility over in France. Have Veolia done this because they're staunch advocates of the green agenda? No. Huge multinational corporations like Veolia invest in large capex projects like this for one reason and one reason only. And that reason is return on investment. According to the International Renewable Energy Agency, or IRENA, recovered materials from PV panels could be worth $450 million by 2030 and more than $15 billion by 2050. And wind turbine recycling is also gaining traction in European countries, with Germany leading the way. According to this 2018 report by Anna Ringel for DPA International Online, Germany is a world leader when it comes to wind power. There are nearly 30,000 wind turbines in operation, providing more power to the grid than in any other European country. There are several elements to a wind turbine which makes the recycling of the entire unit significantly more complicated than recycling a solar panel. Civil engineer Francesco Michelli specialises in turnkey wind farm projects. He's based in Hamburg in Germany, and he writes a blog about the challenges and opportunities facing the industry. In this article from January 1st, 2019, Francesco explains, "The least problematic element is the tower. It's usually made of steel and it can be easily sold at the current market price. The foundation is another element that can be left untouched below ground or demolished. The resulting material can be used again in construction. The nacelle has several different elements, including some that are potentially contaminating, for example, the oil in the gearbox. More complex to recycle, but still doable. By far the most challenging components are the blades. Usually they're made of composite materials, steel and glass or carbon fiber reinforcement in a polymer matrix. And usually this matrix is thermoset, meaning that the polymers are cross-linked, which is to say that it's very difficult to separate out the various elements. But solutions to even this tricky problem are being commercially pursued. One European company at the forefront of this fledgling market is called Neocomp. According to Anna Ringel, Bremen-based Neocomp was set up in 2015. It shreds decommissioned rotor blades, mixing the chippings, largely of glass fiber, with residues from paper manufacture for sale to the cement industry. "Demand is so high," explains Chief Executive Hans-Dieter Wilken, "that we could in fact produce more." Comparatively few wind turbines are being decommissioned right at the moment, but as more and more of them come to the end of their working lives over the coming decades, so these new industries will grow rapidly, providing thousands of new jobs in rapidly changing economies. Over in the USA, similar initiatives are beginning to take shape, at least for solar panel recycling, but the movement is very much in its infancy. Back at the Solar Power World website, Kelly Pickerel spoke with Sam van der Hoof, owner of a consulting firm called Solar Cowboys and former president of Scott Solar. Kelly explains, "Van der Hoof and a few colleagues recently started a new recycling program in the United States, Recycle PV, modeled after Europe's successful program. The program is still in its very early stages, but van der Hoof hopes his efforts will start a movement. The plan for Recycle PV, he says, is to get volumes large enough to build a dedicated solar recycling plant in the United States. Once Recycle PV is processing 10,000 panels a month, a US facility will make more sense. It's not an outrageous goal," claims van der Hoof. "Right now in Europe, they can recycle that much a day." Kelly Pickerel also spoke to Cara Libby at the Electric Power Research Institute, or EPRI. Libby has a slightly different take on this fledgling sector. She suggests that the European model relies on the strong regulatory framework that exists there to ensure that recycling is carried out. Libby states, "It's still a little premature for dedicated PV recycling facilities in the United States. In the future, maybe around 2030, there will be a surge in PV waste volumes. Then we'll have to start thinking about a better way to collect and recycle efficiently." Which, to my ears, sounds a lot like, let's wait until we've definitely got a massive problem and then start to think about whether we should implement a solution. Will we ever learn, do you think? Well, alongside Vanderhoof's Recycle PV initiative, you do have a couple of other beacons of hope over there across the pond in the US. Kelly's Solar Power World website goes on to tell us there are a few states trying to get the required recycling ball moving. In July 2017, Washington became the first state to pass a solar stewardship bill requiring manufacturers selling solar products into the state to have end-of-life recycling programs for their own products. Manufacturers that don't provide a recycling program or outline will not be able to sell solar modules into the state after January 1st, 2021. Regional take-back locations will be set up to accept solar panels at no cost to the system owner, and the state may charge manufacturers for the program. Washington-based solar panel manufacturer iTech Energy assisted with the bill's writing. "Most of us here at the company feel strongly about being strong environmental stewards," said Evan Bush, Special Programs Coordinator at iTech. "It's important to spearhead these efforts before there's a big volume that will need to be disposed of. With this in place, we'll be more prepared." New York had a similar bill on the Senate calendar in 2018, which would require solar panel manufacturers to collect end-of-life panels for recycling. And California's SB 489 passed in 2015 and encourages safe disposal of old panels. California designates end-of-life solar panels as universal waste, a type of hazardous waste that's widely used in homes and businesses like TVs or batteries. By California law, universal waste cannot be trashed or landfilled. But as is so often the case in this brave new world, the biggest challenges can be found in Asia, and in particular in the stratospheric growth of renewables in China. Here's just one example of the scale of their ambition: the Longyang Shi Dam Solar Park in Shanghai, seen from space. 4 million solar panels across 27 square kilometers of land, generating enough power for 200,000 homes. And that scale of production will inevitably mean a similar scale of waste a few decades from now. Returning to the International Renewable Energy Agency report, we're provided with this chart showing how China's solar power waste will stack up as we move towards 2050. The obstacle in this part of the world is not technological or even economical. At least up until recently, it's just been a simple lack of awareness that there's even a problem at all. According to this report for thesixthtone.com, the urgency of solar panel recycling hasn't yet dawned on most manufacturers. In China, expenses related to the handling of solar panel waste disposal or recycling aren't factored into production costs. And that's different from Europe, where a directive requiring producers to take responsibility for recycling the panels they sell has been in place since 2012. There could be a big payoff for getting a head start on recycling. According to international consulting firm Global Market Insights, there's a huge untapped potential for a solar panel recycling industry. The global solar panel recycling management market is likely to be worth $360 million by 2024, with the Chinese market exceeding $50 million. And let's not forget our earlier prediction of $15 billion by 2050. Peng Peng, General Secretary of the China New Energy Investment and Finance Alliance, a non-profit that helps connect renewable energy organizations, compared solar waste to the peak of the electronic waste problem between 2010 and 2015. Just as China introduced rules on electronic waste, stopping it from becoming the dumping site for the world's toxic electronic scraps, so Peng believes that China could do the same before solar waste becomes critical in 2030. As we've seen on so many occasions, there's simply no one silver bullet that will solve all the problems of our climate crisis, and many of the new, apparently sustainable solutions clearly bring with them some very significant challenges of their own. On the other hand, as the European model so clearly demonstrates, the solutions are already in place and in many cases quite well established. It's yet another example of how national and international government regulation and incentive will play a key role in kickstarting commercial actors into doing the right thing environmentally, with the more visionary entrepreneurs spotting an opportunity for big windfalls if they can be the first to corner a brand new market. That's it for this week. Hopefully another thought-provoking topic, and one that will no doubt generate some conversation down in the comments section below. Please do give us a like and a share if you found the program useful. The most effective way you can boost the channel at the moment, though, is to subscribe if you haven't already done so. were growing quite consistently in 2019. In fact, on current growth rates, we should be nudging towards the 10,000 subscriber mark in the next few weeks. Your support will be invaluable to help us get there and get this message out to as wide an audience as possible. It's dead easy to subscribe and it's completely free. All you need to do is click that link there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week and remember to just have a think. See you next week.